quite an operation to launch the Ventura.
A huge tractor, huge trailer.
Something on there, don't know what.
Double of pukas, boys! Double bangers, boys! Oh, yeah!
Doors!
Welcome to yet another feature-length episode right here on ultimatefishing.tv. And this is a very memorable trip for me. I'm a Kiwi, New Zealander, there's no mistaking that. I love this place, I love the people, and this episode kind of sums it all up. It was part of New Zealand I'd never been to before. I'd been invited down there as a judge for a wild food cooking competition. But of course, first we had to go out and harvest some of our wild food from the land and from the sea.
Yeah, well, I can't keep up with this 11-year-old girl's teaching me how to pig hunt.
And doing so, I met some amazing and inspirational Kiwis. We had a heck of a great time. Something on there, don't know what.
Double of pukas, boys!
So, enjoy this very Kiwi of episodes right here, for free, at ultimatefishing.tv.
This week we've come to the Wairarapa, one of the most wild and remote coastlines in New Zealand. And here, the industrious locals have adapted their boats and built mega tractors to access the bountiful fish and seafood.
Oh, hello.
As soon as I got to the bottom that time, this feels good to be hooked up.
But the sea isn't the only source of food and adventure. Up in the hills, there's wild deer and wild boars. And with all this wild food on offer, we find out that the locals are just as creative with their ways of cooking wild game as they are with catching it.
Paua pai. Oh boy. Well, like most Kiwis, I love visiting new parts of New Zealand. Well, more than visiting, I love experiencing new parts of New Zealand. And with my love of fishing, diving, and hunting, it's a wonder it's taken me this long to find this place, Whakataki, or Whakataki, depending which part of New Zealand you're from. It's on the Wairarapa Coast. It's got amazing options for getting wild food, and we're starting out by hooking up with Sean and his daughter Jenna, who are local pig hunters, because for the Mullen family, pig hunting is a family affair. And what do you reckon, Sean? How far do you reckon we've got to go before we're going to run into pigs?
There's a run there, bit of pig sign there, bit of a wallow probably last night, so the pig's probably still hanging around, so chances are probably quite high today. So they're all pig marks, average pigs.
Sean being, well, the local pig hunting legend, is sussed out by these tracks that there's pigs down here, so we're going to go up above them so we can chase them down the hill. We've got some guys waiting with more dogs down the bottom of the hill, and we've got Bryn, you can see. She, just checking, she is winding, and what that is trying to sniff the boar scent, because dogs see the world much differently than we do. They see it in smells as much as they do in sight. Dog's starting to get a little bit of wind. Now when Bryn jumps off the bike, that's when she's satisfied. Now, yeah, there she goes. She's obviously got some scent.
Smells sheep. Probably what she's paying in.
Oh, she's keener now. Oh, look at this. The bloody things are trying to cross behind us. Cunning. Look at that.
Have his big legs, Lindsay.
Old Brinny Gills onto them.
The sow.
The bloody cunning things are trying to cross over behind us.
Don't you, sow.
How old are you, Jenna? 11. My daughter's 11. I can't see her running through gorse, no qualms at all, on her way to a pig bale, just like it's second nature. I can't keep up with this 11-year-old girl's teaching me how to pig hunt. Oh yeah, I can hear scoffing just over here, Dave, to our left. Can you hear it, Jenna? It's just over here, I think. Is there a quicker way around, is it? Oh yeah. No, I should just shut up and listen, really? Oh, you alright? You know I could hear the pig back up here, eh? Oh, does it go down and then back up, you reckon? Oh, we better keep up, but I think we've gone past the pig, eh? Did you hear it back up there? The 11-year-old girl in red bands and I can't keep up.
we'll just have a listen, eh, guys?
She's just up on that plateau.
Yeah, still back up where there. We went past it. Oh, a bit of uphill action. Let's see if we can keep up with you going uphill, eh? Oh, she's let it go. Oh, she's decided she's going to release it herself. She knew what the plan was. Right, so what we've divulged here is that they're just small sows, so the dog goes back on the lead so it doesn't continue chasing them, and we'll continue on and look for a boar. Lead the way, take us to your boar spot, Jenna. Oh, let's go back to the bike, regroup and start again. We're pretty lucky in this case. Old Bryn, he buggered after hanging onto that sow for a little while. So we've gone to the bench, and this is the new recruit, Fetu. It's like bringing Sunny Bill off the bench. Probably wouldn't start with him personally, but a bit of an impact. The dog, that is.
We have one more go, Jens. We'll pull the pin, we'll go to Sava. Tracks just up here, guys.
Bit of a scrap, that sounds better, that sounds better.
Go, yep. Mate, go.
Let go of the gang.
We go, go.
Yep, squealing, they got it.
Sow.
They got the pig. We want to get there as soon as possible.
We're on the Wairarapa Coast to experience the fishing and seafood on this wild and bountiful coast. And we're also after some wild pork. So a note to viewers that in the following scene, an animal is killed for food. So viewer discretion is advised. And for the keen pig hunters out there, we've got more pig hunting action from this trip available on our website.
Keep up, fellas. Oh, babe. Okay. That's over for that pig now. Well, it was all pretty full on. And you can just see just how much hard work it is to get one of these animals. Beautiful to be a native like this. We've secured just a beautiful young boar, eh?
Beautiful weeder.
Mate.
Fat and solid.
Yeah.
Very strong animal.
I tell you what, strong, I know how strong it was. It took this creek to sort of stop it. And some of what you've seen there, well, you won't see, we may censor it because unfortunately, in this day and age, that sort of stuff's become taboo. Whereas I think it's great to have young ladies like Jenna out here training these dogs to catch boars. Well done, Jenna. The real hero in the story are the people that train these dogs and the dogs themselves. And it's you certainly get an understanding of where your food comes from, don't you, Jenna? Look at that. Good on you, Fedu. Good work, dog. Men and dogs working together as they have done for centuries to hunt down some food. Well, should I say men, dogs, and 11-year-old girls. And while this is a serious food gathering mission, I think it's also pretty cool that we can have a trophy, a photo, but still good to be proud of what we've done.
Oh, got it, you carry it.
Okay, which way? Lead on.
Straight up there, Lindsay.
It's all downhill too, that's a bugger. Better get a few shots, Dave, in case my knee blows out. Well, before it does blow out, rather. I'd love to tell you that it was a 2-hour carry and I just manned it out over that ridge. 50 metres. Sweetest carry I've ever had.
Our boar weighed in at 67 kg, which is 150 pound. And we slung it straight in the chiller, so not to waste a minute of time. Because the weather has settled down just enough for us to head out to Castle Point and launch into the next phase of our trip, fishing.
Well, with our wild pork all sorted, the next part of the operation is to get some seafood. And that's what these weapons are for. We've also got some freediving gear, and we're going out on this thing here. Probably, well, definitely the biggest trailer boat I've ever seen.
local skipper, Dean. He's an amazing guy. He's got a really interesting story which we'll find out about. But first, he's going to take us out to see if we can get some grouper. And then perhaps we'll jump in the water for paua and crayfish.
Quite an operation to launch the Ventura, and it's amazing, you know, this is how all the cray boats operate here. There's no port, so they've built these huge cray boats, put them on massive trailers with big tractors. That's what I love about New Zealand, you know, if there's a problem, you just do what you got to do to sort it out. Well, Dean, it looks like it's a little bit wobbly today, but I guess that's normal for you fellas down here.
Yeah, the odd nice day.
Obviously it's in every skipper's best interest to sort of talk down our chances, but everyone I've spoken to said, oh, Dean will put you on fish, guaranteed. Guaranteed, oh, no. He's the man.
Yeah, okay. Hopefully they didn't go jinxing me.
Yeah. In fact, everyone around town's got plenty of good things to say about you. I won't bang on about it because I know it's embarrassing. We'll do it with voiceover.
We first caught up with Dean Hatchard and got a glimpse of his resourcefulness when he was taking his son wakeboarding. It was too rough to take the boat out, so with his classic Kiwi can-do attitude, he just adapted to make it happen. But a good attitude and making things happen is nothing new for Dean. 20 years ago, he lost the use of his legs in an accident. But rather than throw the towel in, he decided to take over the family crayfishing business that his father had worked hard to establish. To do this, he designed and built a boat that would not only have to be capable of fishing this wild coast, but that he could get on and off and operate on his own. And that's exactly what he's done.
Yeah, we've just got a couple of recreational pops.
There you go. Now, of course, the Ventura here, day to day, is a commercial crayfishing boat. We've deregistered it for the day so we can go recreational fishing. And I asked Dean about getting us some crays, so he set some recreational pots for us, and fingers crossed, because with the conditions the way they are, it might be hard for us to go for a dive today. Out on the boys, look, got the white gummies on, we're working the deck, oh yes. Pot of crays. So is this what you fellas would call a good haul for a pot typically, or average?
Oh, not too bad.
Not too bad? Far out. This pot go out yesterday, did it, Dean?
Yeah.
Yesterday, so there you go, overnight. You can see these boys done this before. I've never really done any wreck cray potting before. Good way to get a feed of crays without getting wet. Don't
have to
go far, do you?
Yeah, it's nice being able to work the water from in here. Now that way I can see the depth and also how big the fowl is. Well, there's another three to go.
We've got plenty of crays that are going to be cooked up later on in every possible way imaginable. So now it's time for us to rig up the fishing gear as Captain Dean lines us up on the spot. At last, it's fishing time.
Well, there goes the toot, which means drop. And the rig that I'm dropping, the old ledger rig, it seems to be universally used up and down New Zealand, particularly the further south you go, the more prevalent this rig is. And I've just got on a chunk of squid up the top, a chunk of barracuda down the bottom, probably the two go-to baits for fishing in this sort of deeper water. We're in 130 metres, I think, so. They're tough baits, they hold on the hooks, and well, the rig is a proven rig. So I'll start by doing it as the locals do, and if we get onto some fish, I might mix it up a little bit. Show them some of my flash tricks from up north. Pretty tricky for Dean in this instance, He's keeping the boat idling into the wind just to hold us over the marks.
He's a good fisherman, I can tell that already.
Maybe you want to be careful you get a big one on, mate. You might get the old...
Yeah. Oh, bit of fresh bait anyway, Jamie.
Bait, eh?
Yeah.
Getting our bait for us, they're pretty good. They make great puka baits, does the Scarpy. In fact, a lot of the harpooka, bass and stuff that I've gutted, they've had those guys inside them. Bites again, come on. Ooh, it doesn't feel like terribly big fish. That feels better. Oh, yes. Oh, no. Oh, good. Thought that was an all right fish too. Oh, there he goes, Jamie. You did a vicious strike. Yeah, I'm getting bites again over here as well. Obviously coming across a patch of fish here. Something on there, don't know what. We've got a way to pull it in. What have we got, Jamie? You're the local mate, tell us what's going on. Before I can start getting cute with mixing it up and big baits or live baits or lures and stuff, job number one is to get some food on the table. Oh, you got him on over there?
Yeah, man. Oh,
there you go. Jamie's got us started with the terakee. Well done. If I had to say, I'd say I didn't have a terakee, but you know, just feels a little bit heavier. It could be the big sink that I've got on. Oh, what's that? Is that a bastard cod? Bastard cod? Don't see many of them up north. Not in our desirable eating species, really, are they? Oh, there you go, that's better. Gee, they're nice sized terakee. There you go.
Tarakihi are great eating, and south of the Bay of Plenty, they replace snapper as the staple inshore table fish. But we're also after some of the larger and even tastier trumpeter and groper. That will complete the trifecta of the best eating fish on the coast. And with the weather not the best, looks like we're going to have to work hard for them today.
Lunch, a couple of boat burgers on the go. Keep everyone happy.
Well, these are the little fish that live down there. I know that puka eat them, so that's what I am putting on for my bait. And I've gone to a bigger rig. Looks like these conditions are going to be tough. If I can pull a groper, pull one out of the fire, that's going to feed us all. All set, awaiting the toot to drop. Lovely day for it. And away we go.
Got something on. Don't know if it's on the live bait or the dead bait. But it's a something. Not something terribly big, let's hope it's edible, because we're doing the hard yards out here today. Ah, cooter, is it? Oh, well, we've got some fresh bait, boysy. Barakota!
Well, we're converting this barracuda straight into fresh bait. Excellent bait for puka. It's nice and shiny, reflective, so it's visible down deep. They seem to love the taste of it, but most importantly, it really stays on your hook.
Shakarama.
What you gone and got us? Ah, no, you're joking. We might have to eat them soon. I tell you what, the wind up from almost 200 metres down is getting a little bit tiresome, but fortunately, I've brought along something that'll fix that problem for me.
So I've brought out the Shimano Dendemaru electric reel, but of course you need power. That's where this fella comes in. It's nice and portable, I can bring it with me. It gives me plenty of grunt. It's a cycle battery, so I can run this electric reel all day long. And what's really handy about having your 12 volt battery being so compact and grunty like these Exide batteries is you can even put it in a backpack. So when you're on a boat, you're not plugged into the boat, locked on the spot, you can actually move around the boat.
Alrighty. All set, are we?
Yep.
something's into it.
Boom, 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 boom. Hook up, you bugger.
Yeah, got him. Fighting, whatever it is. Hopefully a trumpy.
It would be mean.
Think it's scrapping a bit much for a kudu, well, I hope so. Come on, be a trumpy. We'll find out in 10 metres time. It's starting to float a little bit, actually. A little bit of line angle coming up.
What is it?
Double of pookas, boys! Double bangers, boys! Oh, yeah! Right, electric does the trick. Now, there could be something in this. Maybe there's not, but something else I did, which is just a little bit kind of electric and tricky, is a little wee strobe light, just to a flashing light that I've attached to my rig there. So it's flashing away down there that draws the attention of fish. And no sooner did that get to the bottom, and boom, two of them on. No one else has caught one, so maybe there is something in it.
But we're eating well now anyway.
Stunning eating. Oh mate, relief. I don't know whether that's joy or relief. Into the salt water and ice slurry.
Beauty.
Oh, lunchtime. Time for one of our manifold burgers. Part of the new slow food revolution, just cooking away all morning. Yeah, bang on, bro. Here we go, here we go. Woo-hoo. Oh, it's all too much like hard work. Yeah, take care of itself. So that's the other option, of course, with the electric reel. You can kind of just really let it do its own thing, and you can chat with your mates. That was straight into them again, Dean, that time.
Yeah.
Just got to the bottom, boom, boom, boom. Are you marking a few then?
Yeah, there's quite a few marks around.
Oh, load it up a wee bit then. They're starting to float, so I'm picking pooka. Yeah, they're floating up on the other side. Hey, we might be stuck under the boat. Oh, you got my line? Oh, trumpy this time. Yeah, yeah. Both baits gone, so I probably had a couple on there. And we want this guy in, or the trumpeter. Fantastic eating fish, delicate flesh. You beauty, right? Well, we seem to be on a bit of a roll, so let's carry on. Right, I'll get you to grab that fish. We might have a fish on this, eh? It's floating up. Little pooka, way to go. Good work, Jamie.
Now, what we've just actually divulged has happened is that Jamie's tangled around Scully's line. And he's actually wound in Scully's fish. So, but we won't tell him, we'll just paint it for you, mate.
Yeah, nice work. Still no luck over there, eh, Scully? Oh well. Well, given now that we've got ourselves a feed of fish, feed of excellent fish too, and given the harpooker is small, I've dropped down back to the lighter tackle just to be a little bit more sporting. Lighter ledger rig as well, back to the 100 pound rig. But one thing I have kept is that little strobe flashing light, because it did seem to make a difference.
Oh, that light?
I really wonder about that light, you know? As soon as I got to the bottom that time, well, I might say the light, but I know that Dean's been working very hard inside the helm there to put us right over fish. Because of course when you're so deep and there's wind and current, you've got to time it so your baits drop right into the middle of the shoal of fish, which may only be the size of a house, the school of fish. Now that sounds big, but when you're 180 metres away from it and everything's moving and it's constantly changing, it's not all that easy to do. Oh, this feels good to be hooked up. There we go. Two pookas on the light tackle rig, and there's that light again. Satisfaction. I've gone from relief to satisfaction now. Yeah, we've just got to keep Sky away from the line. He actually broke the line, but we caught the fish.
Brace of puppy pockers.
We've toughed it out. Well, it's hardly been tough. Certainly hasn't been tough for me. It might have been tough for the camera crew. But while the conditions have been challenging, we've got a great feed of fish.
Oh, here he goes. Here he goes. I've gone and taken the net away from Scoey. He's managed to so far tangle up with everybody, bust his own fish off, and then try and bust mine off. So
relinquished him of his duties.
Scoey, go sit in the corner and have a good hard think about
yourself. Jamie's got a good one.
Hey, Jamie's on a good one there too. Oh well, we're into a few good fish. It appears, watching Jamie and also watching Lindsay here, that the local technique is known as the winch.
Yeah, man.
Stand and deliver. I'll tell you what, these reels, these Dakotas, they just custom made for it. They love it. They love the punishment. There we go.
Oh,
Trumpy, nice Trumpy. Take your time. There we go, that's a nice Trumpy. You're beauty. Oh, yeah.
Jaws.
Now, one thing about trumpeter, you may or may not know, probably do know, being a local, is they're the one of the very few fish that brews. So you've got to handle them carefully. They don't like other fish being packed on top of them. If you drop them on deck, the flesh bleeds. Anyway, we've got to go and see our mate over here. We've got colour. Okay. Jamie, the human winch. He's crushing it.
So good for kids to be out here. You know, neat to see, you know, father and son.
There we go, mate. Oh yeah, keep them in the water, mate. It's a bass. Oh mate, another species, and another good eating species at that. There we go, a little wee bass. Woo-hoo! Well done. Yeah, it's a beautiful little bass. A few bites. Ooh. Oh, there we go. We'll take that. Oh, there we go. I've now just completed the Wairarapa slam. The big three on the Wairarapa Coast, and we had to do it in some pretty testing conditions. But it's mission accomplished. We've got some fresh fish to accomplish, and let's not forget our crayfish, because we're on our way back in shortly, because there's a very special cook-off about to happen, of which I have been nominated judge. That's right, I'm gonna have to eat crayfish and paua.
Okay, you guys, we'll pull the pin, eh? We're gonna shoot out here. Yeah.
Dildy!
Swapping around.
Despite the challenging conditions, we caught all the fish we needed. So we blasted our way back to Castle Point, where a small crowd has gathered to see this remarkable way of retrieving a 40-foot boat from a surf beach.
Oh yeah, here we go. Back at the beach, our man's got a tractor in place in this gigantic trailer. And look at that, straight on. You know, in what otherwise would be pretty well an inaccessible spot. Look at this, Kiwi ingenuity. I love this about New Zealand, this sort of thing. Brilliant. So we're just gonna pull the boat out of the water now, and we'll be seeing you back at the pub very shortly for our paua and crayfish cook-off. I feel like I'm Santa at the Christmas parade. Look at that.
Well, today I've had plenty of interest from the fellas in the rig I'm using. So for our tackle tip, I'm just gonna run you through exactly how I made it up, because it's just quite a basic homemade rig. I'm using 100 pound. It's sort of quite an all-round sort of a weight. I've got there about a metre and a half, and all I'm doing first, about one third of the way along, is I'm tying a dropper loop, and this is the important part. So I make a loop about yay big, I hold that in my mouth, and I just twist. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then I take it back through the hole that I've made there. I pull it up, and that's the dropper loop. I simply double that up, and that gives us our two loops. And now we go to the fancy part. These are luminous squid shells. Now, for the hook to sit correctly, it's important that you go through the front of the hook and then loop it over the hook and pull it up. And then we just slide up our little wee squid here. And that gives it some luminescence, so a glow underwater, which is going to attract the fish.
And down the bottom, I just have a loop so I can loop the loop my sinker on. And here's the completed rig ready to attach to your line and fish. And as you've seen, it's capable of catching everything from terakee to grouper. Well, we're back at the Whakataki Hotel. We've got entrants literally turning up as we speak for the Whakataki Hotel famous crayfish and paua cook-off. And I've whipped out the back to whip up a crayfish dish of my own to see if I can enter into the running and see how it stacks up. And it's a recipe that came about because I couldn't get my wife to eat crayfish, but I did know that she will eat anything that is crumbed and fried. So I thought, well, I'll do some fried crayfish tail. And in order for me to do that, I've got to get the meat out of this tail while the crayfish is still raw. And that's pretty basic, really. I just need to run the knife around that membrane where the tail meets the body. It's really soft. Cut around there, and that tail just pulls out quite easily. Now, what I need to do now is chuck it into my pot that I've got here. You get these from Hunting and Fishing. They're cray cooking pots. They're great. And I'm just dropping that in to that steaming water. And I'm only gonna leave that about 30 seconds. The body here, now this is my favorite part. So that goes in there, they're gonna be steamed later on. That's been in there long enough now, because I don't wanna cook that tail. I just wanna chuck it in the water. And by chucking it in there, that just releases the flesh from the body a wee bit. Oh, it's gonna be pretty hot, so I'm gonna hold it with my tea towel. And I use a pair of scissors just to cut along the underside of the cray there. So just having blanched it, it hasn't cooked, you can see. That's still clear, translucent meat, but it just stops it sticking to the shell. And I can pull that crayfish meat out in one piece, and I've pulled out the old poo tube with it as well, because someone gets a bit of poo tube in their cray tail and they don't like it. We've got this translucent bit of meat here, and you'll see that it's got a natural join down the centre. I just cut down the centre and it falls apart. And now I'm just going to chop this into segments, bite-sized sort of chunks, almost like scallop size. You can use a plastic bag. I've got a Tupperware container this time. I've just got breadcrumbs, flour, and a few of my secret herbs and spices in there. And I'm just chucking the chunks of cray tail in there. Bung the lid back on, because this is just a quick way of getting them all coated. Just giving it a good old shake up there. Just got some oil here going on the barbie, but pretty soon they'll start fizzing away. And I tell you what, while that's heating up and we're waiting for those to cook, of course the bodies and the rest of the crays, they go straight into our crayfishing pot. They come with this basket. They're a great thing, particularly when you've got a lot of crays like we have and a whole bunch of people to feed. We'll be able to bung those in, and we'll just be able to do the straight out boiled, part boiled. We only got a little bit of water in the bottom there, just with some salt, part boiled, part steamed. For those smaller crays, 8 minutes, so set the timer going. And these can be our control, just your stock standard boiled cray, nothing wrong with it at all. But fizzing away over here now is gonna be the exciting bit, the crumbed crayfish tail. Be interesting to see what the other judges think. Oh yeah, look at that. Okay, I'm gonna have to enter them under another name, of course, so they don't know that I've cooked them. Sharon Cook. This is the entry from Sharon Cook. Well, this is the moment we've all been waiting for. Well, I've been waiting for since I've got here, and that is the taste test. Myself and my esteemed judges here, and I don't know what you had to do to be a judge, but it's a pretty good job. And here's the first dish on its way right now.
Crayfish delicacies.
Crayfish delicacies, ooh. Very cunning, but you wrap anything in bacon, it's gonna taste good. That's smart. That was pretty good, bacon. A little bit sweet though.
Paua fritters.
Oh. Just about back to two, there's a bit of shell in there. These are the old mate Sean's. I really wanted to give him a good score, but they're terrible. Sorry, mate. Paua pie. Pahoy. They're not the little pre-bought numbers either.
Good for a hangover.
Cream paua. Quite a traditional way of preparing paua. Quite rich. But I've had some good ones, so I'll be interested to see how this one stacks up. Flavour's good. Could have done a bit more work on the tenderising. I've got a few. There's a few tricks for tenderising paua that I'm surprised people don't try more.
Number 8 crayfish cocktails.
Oh, too sweet.
Mild chilli paua fritters.
Can't taste chilli.
Crayfish mornay bread cases.
Oh, yeah.
Paua patties.
Oh, they look good. And they're a patty, not a fritter. Interesting distinction made there. Good.
This is last year's winning dish, Barbara Bracken's curried cray.
Oh, curried cray. I was waiting for a curried cray to turn up. Plain.
Paua surprise.
Right, number of that.
Now we're talking. This recipe will be one that makes it to our website.
It's getting full yet?
No, I'm pacing myself.
27 crayfish medallions.
Oh, yeah. Oh, look right at that. And that's not a sauce, that's a jus, I think you'll find. Oh, disappointing. Crayfish is rich enough as it is. You know, like adding cream to crayfish and butter to, you know, you have something that's already rich.
This is Marjorie Mullins creamed paua. It's Barbara Bracken's paua fritters. Gillian Buckman's creamed paua.
Oh, I like the presentation. Good. But more soft.
Chili and lime crayfish.
Oh yeah, presentation looks great. Chili and lime cray. Oh, it's cold. Oh yeah. Oh no, it's got coriander on it. The one thing I don't like in the world.
Lightly smoked crayfish risotto.
Oh, got to get that recipe.
This is Sarah Cook's crayfish nibbles.
Oh, they look good. We'll see how they go.
Oh,
yes. Yes.
No, don't
know.
Do you want half of that or do you want the whole lot?
No, I want the whole lot. This is entry 36, crayfish
chowder. Oh, does look good. Gotta get a bit of cray. It wasn't crayfish, it was a ball of flour. I'll try and put that out of my mind. That could have been a winner had it not been for the lump of flour. Oh, cleaned out. I had my eye on some more of those.
Lime infused cray tail.
Yeah. No one served me up the guts yet. It's the best bit. Paua sticks now. Yeah. So that's what we were just talking about. This is normally how I rack my paua's up on the barbie, just like this. Sweet. Bashed, bit of garlic, sliced up, put on the barbie.
And that was the final dish, guys, so I hope your tummies aren't too sore.
Oh, well. Well, while we confer and digest the result, and, well, digest the food, we'll come back to you very shortly with the winner. We're going to mention the place getters, but I will point out place getters don't get a prize because pretty much it's first and then everyone else is a loser. There were some fantastic dishes. There were no bad ones. Oh, actually a couple. We're starting with paua. Third place with paua fritters was Trev Beaver. Second, also with a paua fritter, was Kim O'Neill. And our first place getter, who name will be adorning this amazing plaque on the wall here. Good, clean, honest paua sticks, Jimmy Christensen. Well done, Jimmy. Now we move on to the crayfish. And it was a closely run thing, the crayfish. Some great dishes in there. Now there is 3 second equals. Buddy.
Yes!
Buddy with your cray chowder. That was blooming good. Kim O'Neill with her crayfish cocktails. Kim, second equal. And another second equal place getter was Matt Watson with crayfish nibbles. I might add that I didn't score them as my favourite, so I wasn't biased. So it was the other judges here doing that, and they had no idea it was from me either, I might point out. But hands down, I've got to say, I was beaten by the better person on the day. Well, let's say the better woman on the day.
It was the chili lime cray from Mary Taylor. Takes it out. Right down the back.
Do you know what?
This story, look.
Oh, hip hop. I'll take that one.
Well done.
Oh my God, that's unbelievable because, do you know what?
Have you got enough tape, Dave? Well done. Okay, so I just...
Yes.
There we go.
Right.
Well
now
deserved.
I am so tough.
Well deserved.
I think that's all we've got time for this week on the ITM Fishing Show. See you next time, because I've got something to do. I don't know whether I've got a run out of here or not, because there's only one winner and a whole lot of losers here. So.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed this episode. But if you want to see the most up-to-date action, including this swordfish that I'm hooked up to now that's about to jump, you can get more action for free, as well as all the tips that go with it, at ultimatefishing.tv or download the Ultimate Fishing app. Here we go. Oh, there he goes out there.